Hello, everybody, and welcome to another Archon's Corner. We got an exciting week this week, as there is myself, Dr. Sheep, and Big Z.
Hey, hey, it's just us, too. It's been a while since we just had a duo cast.
And beautiful silence.
No Wookiee, no, I think he is busy setting up a brand new store. Oh, where's JR? Dan, I think I missed that.
He is in Florida on vacation.
Nice. He needs a vacation from all the work we put him through here at Archon's Corner.
And Wookiee is
stuff
actually,
we got going on.
Wookiee is proving that the pandemic is not over. He is working extra hours because one of his co-store managers or something got the vid. He's covering again. So
yes.
Okay. Sadly, that is not over.
It is not over. If you are willing, able, go out and get yourself a vaccine. If you're not, that is your choice as well. All right, but we're going to get into some Keyforge. So why I suck at Keyforge, not casting for that. Why I suck at Keyforge, I'm going to cover something that I call the S-tier myth. This isn't an actual like play experience of why people suck at Keyforge. This is something that I've come across in coaching. Go ahead.
Yeah, I was going to say, it definitely puts people in a mindset that leads them to losses.
And I understand why there is this mindset, because it does exist in most games. It just doesn't exist in this one. But yeah, as I mentioned before, I've coached people at either from my team or occasionally via contract. But the first thing I have to do quite often is dispel the idea of the S tier. So before I get into that, in any kind of game, what would S tier refer to, Dan? Like, what are your thoughts when you hear S tier?
You know, it's funny how S tier, which I know it's based off letter grading, right? But it comes out of the Asian region, right? Where S is the highest grade you can get. Because I'm like, I'm from a little farming community. I'm like, there's nothing better than A, man.
Yeah, it's A. That's all there is.
So, but S is like above A. It's like the super tier, the special tier, I don't know. I guess I don't
even
know
even lots of even lots of video games will do that. Like, you'll have medals for how well you completed the stage, and it'll be like B through A, and then there's this S if you did it somehow perfectly, which you can almost never get in those games without hacks or something. But S tier is like this idea of this is the perfect answer to all things and everything. So in a card game, like if it's Magic and you're playing in a certain meta, the S tier deck for that meta would be like, here's the deck that has the 99% win rate and almost doesn't care about what you're playing against. I have never played Magic at that level, but I've had friends that do and have won events. I've always talked about these certain decks that came around in certain iterations, and that was this S tier thing that you'd go spend a ton of money, or in some cases not a ton of money, but you just go get all these cards, you have this deck, you win most of the time. So
yeah,
one of the first...
With Magic, you hit the guy with the same deck, and now you're coin flipping.
Yeah, who gets to go first or whatever it is, who mulligans into the thing that they need after they mulligan the time.
Yes.
So that's the
everything else.
So there are, like, I think I have run into people that have, like, to some extent, a level of suck at Keyforge because they hold on to this idea. They're constantly searching for this S-tier deck. And, like, one of the things that I have to coach them through or talk about through, or we just, like, look at the way the game was designed to get there. There is no such thing as an S deck. There are amazing decks in Keyforge, but not a single one of them printed to this day does not have a weakness that is somewhat significant. There's not, none of these decks don't have decks out there that just won't come in and crush them almost every time, actually. And that is the true nature of Keyforge. Like when I grade stuff for, sometimes I will rate someone's an entire collection. I'll literally go through in every single deck. I will give a letter grade, and it never, ever exceeds A. And rarely will I ever give a deck an A grade. And even I'll even talk that through them. Like, if I'm telling you that this is starting at A-, could be an A with practice, that means that I would have to run a lot of reps to get it from an A- to an A. Because there are some decks that have enough good cards in there, played enough keyboards to know, okay, this should definitely be at least an A-, but I will never say, like, this is a solid A. And there are very few solid A decks, in my opinion, because when I say a deck is a solid A, I'm saying something to the number of players in the vault will obviously change the percent But I'm saying something to the effect of, as long as you pilot this well and are skilled in the way the game is played and do all the other things you need to do at a vault, you have roughly a higher than a 5% chance of going and making day two of a vault. I'm not even saying that they're going to go win with it. Like, to show up and just say you have higher than a 5% chance just because of a deck is a big deal. And most people can't say that with any deck that they own. And that's kind of where I put my A classification. And there is no such thing as an S tier deck, because an S tier deck, you would like, oh, this deck is so good, I'm going to walk in and actually expect to win with the deck just because I have this deck. There's just too many counters. Like, I can name some of the best decks in the world, and then I can give you a list of other decks in the competitive field that will regularly just crush them.
I think there may have been your mythical S tier deck before they got rid of lands.
Yes. Maybe. Yeah. There were three decks that we were identified in our net decking competition. I own one of the three that every time I saw them play, the odds that they were winning that game were so phenomenally high, it was borderline ridiculous. So pre-lands nerf, I think there was about as close as you were ever going to see in the S tier land, which does fully justify part, you know, one of the reasons why it's justified that lands is not a thing anymore, because that did exist. Like, there was a land that existed long ago where the deck did have a greater than that percentage of chance just by entering an event to win the whole thing.
Oh, but as Keyforge, and with our limits of whatever's in the deck, like, even an S tier lands deck can have its two most important cards as the last cards and just get outraced.
Yeah.
I mean, in
the current meta, we even have Jar and stuff now. So, like, I don't even know.
Sure.
Like, during the time that they played, and I think actually all the way through Worlds Collide, that S tier classic probably would have stuck. But then you would have just seen lots of Jar decks come MM. Like they would have just had to have Jar decks.
Yeah. And that's no fun. So, I mean, even right now, either. You know, yeah. As a team along AC, when we're talking, like, our feeling for R has hard R artifact control is significantly been increasing as of late.
Yeah, because it used to be super high back in Land's era. It's basically if you did not have at least a remote access, there was just a bunch of decks that weren't even that great necessarily that would just wreck you because they had the Land's combo. And if you didn't have a way to answer it, just lose. it was a thing, and they addressed it, and it's gone. But anyway, that's the myth. One of the myths that I would like to tell, and why I think some people kind of are sucking at Keyforge at times, because they are on this quest for something that does not exist. If you are out there constantly striving and looking and whatever and grinding, like through decks and eBay and all this other stuff, looking for the S tier, it is not there. The way you're going to be a winning player at Keyforge is get you to finding what is good for you, what matches your playstyle, getting reps with that, and understanding how the meta is shifting gradually over the month.
I also think that, like I say, in that mindset, that S tier myth leads to people having overconfidence in their deck because they think they have an A, or, you know, maybe they think it's an S, but they think they have an A tier deck and they're playing a B tier deck and go, well, I'm just favored enough that they don't put in as much time, especially in like this KFPL practice. I've seen that bite more than one player.
Maybe someone on our team.
Maybe two on our team. Had a rough roll with that lately.
It happened.
For sure. And, you know, like, that might have been part of my loss to Sad Crybear, too, here this week. Sadly, guys, I did not win KFPL. I'm now 3-2 and a little bit fighting for a good position, but I feel pretty good. I'll still make a top three berth here. But I got my practice games in, but I probably only did two games per match that I thought was likely to happen. You know, that was just a lot of life coming in and not allowing enough time to play Keyforge. And I don't know if that led into my two, where, you know, like the two games I played with each were pretty handily in my favor. So I'm like, well, I feel like I got this. And then I go and play the real thing and I'm just fighting for my life the whole game and lost. And Yeah, I think I know what I need to do, but clearly that was just not it.
Yeah, I mean, I got to hear your recap of them, so we'll see how next week goes and see what happens. Who do you play last?
I play week 7? SC Steel. Congrats on joining the Help from Future Self guys and casting over with them. And then, I play her, although I'm pretty sure she promised me pina coladas if I come down and play at her house. And she only lives like a half an hour from where I work, so.
Oh, so we might have an in-person game, huh?
Yeah, except because of team decks, I actually only have in possession one of my three decks, right?
This is true. And I'm not shipping them.
No, I believe Sydney is in the same position where she is not in physical possession of the deck she's playing.
Oh, no, she is not either. USPS literally lost a delivery last week. And then in my mind, like it was like a sub-$100 deck. So I was like, whatever.
Yeah, but money. If it was one of these, it'd be.
Yeah, I don't know. I would be distraught.
Yeah, I kind of remember hearing some story about anxiety of shipping a Vault Tour winning deck around
the world. Yeah. Yeah. Like at some point,
the anxiety it caused.
At some point, we made it a little easier by me going to Germany, take a deck to somebody, and then get a deck from somebody, and then exchange them in person at the next vault. I saw the other people because at some point, like if I were to ship my best three decks anywhere and insure them, I would not give a crap if I got the insurance money back.
Yeah, because you can't replace them.
Like, I just lost something that can't ever be replaced. No way, no how, impossible. And, like, even if I put it in an inflated insurance value, I would still be more upset over the loss of the deck than any number I return.
It's weird. Yeah, it's sad to think that I'd want to pay a courier, you know, like,
like a physical transport person that you know, yeah,
or something that, you know, something much more like that than you know,
like hire, like from the movie. I need to hire the transporter.
Yeah, like, this is traveling in an armored BMW or an Audi.
Like I'm strapping this to your hand.
You get anywhere near my deck, this guy's punching you in the face.
That's right. He's a carrying member.
All right, let's carry on. Right, so bad news now. Sad days.
Yes. We've got good and bad news. We'll start with the bad. So go ahead. This is your thing, Dan.
Well, so we have heard. I actually haven't got this news personally from my thing, but from the sources I've been seeing outside of mine. Set 6, Dark Tidings, delayed now for North America until May 16th, I believe was the date.
That is the date that I have not had it officially confirmed from my vendor either. That I'm hearing all over the place. I thought it was April 1st shenanigans. This is that time of year. But I think it is sticking. So I'm holding my breath to hope that it is not. But I believe I'm 90% sure that this is a delay. May 16th is what we're hearing now. I know all of us, all we want to do is play Dark Tidings. It looks fun. I'm excited about it. As I said previously on the cast, I've already upped my order to a ton of decks. Lots of people I know are upping their order. But it does look like we will now have, a full month and a half now recording.
When did Mass Mutation come out? September?
July. That's when I came back.
So that's like, we are going to be damn near a year between sets.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, because I took most of the summer off. Mid-July, MM came back. I came back in. And just a lot.
That's...
We are, as of right now, we are 9 months without new sets. Right? Yep, 9. So that will be 10. So we'll see. None of our stuff is from FFG. But I would assume it does have something to do with the worldwide logistics bottleneck that happened last week.
Yep.
We can't fault FFG for that. Can't fault, you know, the what happened to the world. crazy things have been happening every single month since 2020.
Now, you know, like the thing is, just because that's freed up, now that just means every port is now backlogged because
That's what I was talking about. That's what they've been saying. Like if that the way our world is so globally connected, when anything hits a major logistical like pipeline, that's going to affect a bunch of other things. But anyway, on a positive note, we had two events within the last month, I think fairly recently as of this cast, that had Asmodee financial involvement. So one was in Italy, one was in China. So like a lot of people already saw the things posted about the Chinese events, who actually had a prize wall where you could turn in your amber shards. And then they had cash prizing because they were sponsored by Asmodee. I don't know if it's actually called Asmodee Direct there, but an Asmodee like parent corporation, because Asmodee owns Fantasy Flight. And then they also are involved with the, I think it's just called the Keyforge Network, which is an Italian keyforging group. They sponsored an event with Asmodee support that I don't think they got cash, because when I was talking to a member of Team SAS that is involved with that event, I don't think you can actually give cash prizes in Italy for some reason. But they did get product support for the winners in the form of different sets displays for different ranked players events that they were directly from the company.
Yeah, that's pretty cool. But both of it's not from FFG. It's from parent company or local authorized distributor or something like that.
Which is, I think, a big thing. Like, again, we don't have any sources inside Asmodee or FFG telling us this. All we have is that this happened. These were prizes that were awarded. I think this could be a really positive thing for the future of organized play inside of Keyforge, because I don't know if this means that there's some kind of hint that other parts of the Asmodee umbrella corporation are going to take over OP for any form of Keyforge. But I do know to date, well, until the day of the Chinese corporation, like FFG had never given anyone money for playing Keyforge. And that changed as of a week ago. So, well, that didn't change for FFG, but, you know, that changed that a entity that supports and owns this game in a way did provide funding for a cash event that we had never seen before. So if this is some kind of inkling of what we might see, because we know they hinted towards a relaunch, which is what, you know, I kind of expected the whole time. Obviously, their design team has made more sets that we are aware of, at least through, what was it, 7? So that's product that they need to move. Nothing is going to move it better than promoting big events. So when we get to the relaunch, I am very interested and hopeful to see what that relaunch entails, and if it is something outside of the FFG that is going to be promoting it with more prizes and events that could lead towards cash payouts.
Yeah, and I'm excited for cash, but I just want events and prizes and reasons.
My motivation is cash payout part, really. It's just the fact that if you do add cash payouts to the game, I think, like I said, we used to talk about this a long time ago when Vault Warrior was coming around, like the higher the top end gets, the more bottom end you'll get too, because it'll just become more popular of a thing. More people will be drawn to it. They'll bring their friends. They'll bring their families. We just have to be strong, like stay strong as a community, and make sure that we're like actively trying to weed out some of the money trolls, which I think our community is really good about that. So it's like strong right now with the way we have it. So I'm excited to see the future. As I said, we're not 100% that's going to happen, but that's a hope. And I think that's something I'm going to be excited to be a part of.
Yep. On that China event, and I don't have 100% confirmation on this either, but that 2000 shard redeem for decks with your name in them supposedly happened. Like, they were able to submit when that first came out, and people have received those decks. We saw some reports of.
That's awesome, because that's one of the things we all talked about. Like, we have that amount of shards, some of us.
Yeah.
And it's like, I'm not going to order a chair that I'm never going to use. For a while, I was thinking about getting the table, but then my wife was like, where are we going to put it? Like, I own a board game table for board games, and it is gigantic. Obviously, the Keyforge table is much smaller. She kind of was helping know.
Supposedly, they are Dark Tidings decks that they got with their names on them.
Yes, I for sure would pay 2,000 shards right now.
Interesting information on that chair is Dave Cordero actually got an email that that chair is supposed to ship next week.
Oh, wow. That is breaking news for Archon's Corner listeners. A chair, if it's supposed to ship next week, must have been made. There is at least one real Keyforge chair in the world right now.
Yep. We'll see if it happens. But like, he got an email from FFG saying, yeah, like, manufacturers said they're going to be able to do it.
All right. So that's some hopeful stuff, fun stuff happening in the future. That's actually also another sign that FFG, what is it? What's Josh's department called? He's not there anymore, but it used to just be prizing. There was some fancy name for like the prizing and
just awards. Organized play, but
OP prizing. I don't know. He had something on his card. He got promoted a long time ago. But anyway, so that is another sign that, you know, the promotions, the FFG promotions department is alive and kicking. They're doing stuff. Speaking of promotions, let's talk about the KFPL real quick. As said last time, the season 2 standings are available and up. We've posted all over the place to kind of show you all snapshots of where people are at. Bunch of people are still vying for top spots. So head on over there, check out the Google web sheet. It has everything there you need to find. We just mentioned the news about the Dark Tidings. So on April 24th, we are going to hold an event. At this time, there's a 90% chance it will not be sealed Dark Tidings. So I'm waiting for further confirmation to finalize that we will be changing the event. I will let you all know next week what the event will be for certain, since we'll be getting to that second week of April. And we, behind the scenes at KFPL, are going to discuss and come up with that, what that'll be looking like if we confirm 100% that there will not be a worldwide availability of Dark Tidings. So even if it does hit Master Vault,
yeah, I was gonna say, are there gonna be decks to make it worthwhile?
Do that? It would be weird. I think we would get way more negative feedback than positive feedback if we did it the other way. So if it is 100% pushed back to May, we will just make May, obviously, our Dark Tidings sealed. Something else for April. All right, what else we got going on? We still doing our weeklies, Dan?
We are still doing our weeklies. So we still have regular Tuesday night sealed and Sunday night chain bound. Both count towards the leaderboard. We did just hand out leaderboard decks for last month, and we have another set of leaderboard decks. So that's the Unnatural Selection, the Not Finish With You, and Tremor decks for the next 3 months. So we're going to keep giving them away. And then typically on Thursdays, we also have a chain bound, although I was vacationing last night and was not able to run it. But I'm going to put out a post and maybe we'll throw together a random Friday event or something.
Sounds fun. They were definitely... There was some, it's the end of the world going on. I was like, guys, he's just on vacation. Chill out.
Yeah. So that's still going on. So that's great.
All right. Cool. We still don't have another big event through AC, but if something comes up.
Because we're basically waiting to run a real Dice or Dark Tidings sealed as well. Like, that's what everybody wants.
I think that, yeah, everyone wants to play Dark Tidings. I think our next big AC event where you can win our last Dusk Runner, right?
Well, yeah, so there's definitely a Dusk Runner, which will probably be a Dark Tidings seal. I still have store championship kits to run, and, you know, maybe I just throw together a French Worlds Collide cheap tournament to fill us in during...
That could be something to do in April, because, I mean, I hope people, whatever we decide on the KFPL, Yeah, we hope people will come out and play in it, but we are aware that it will not be nearly as exciting as coming to play Dark Tidings. Like, there's no event that I can put together that would be like replace the excitement. Just none. But we're going to put together something, and we hope people will come out to play that. But there will definitely be some need for some people to come out and play some fun. So if you can think of something, Dan, we'll all be. All right.
For sure. So then the other thing we're going to talk about, COAT. COAT Season 7 regular rounds have wrapped up. So they are
eight.
Now into
it's
their
eight, right?
Playoffs.
Isn't it eight?
Are we on 8? Yeah, we are on 8. Thank you.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
And this was the SAS climb. So we have 5 teams competing for my awesome disc playmat kits for whoever finishes with the best record. And right now we have Can't Touch Disc, the Aces, who I think they're the one they won last year. Or was that the Wolfpack? One of these Can't Touch Disc teams won last COAT 7. So they favored again. But Can't Touch Disc, the Aces, they took 6 wins in theirs. They have 6 wins in their group, and they're still only second in group, so they have to play in for the finals yet. Right? Because COAT is another one of these ones where the first place team in each group automatically moves in, and then second and third is fighting to get into the top seed, kind of like KFPL. So even at 6 wins, they're second in their group, and I think they have to fight in. And then there's Can't Touch Disc, the Wolfpack. They got 5 wins, but they are first in their group. So they're definitely in the running to win all those sweet prize kit stuff. And then there's...
So question to me, they're first in group. So if Can't Touch Disc, the Aces, since this is your thing, loses this week, does that mean the Wolfpack is automatically ahead of them?
Yes.
Okay. That makes sense. It's going to look weird because if the Wolfpack loses, technically the 6 win team still loses. It's interesting. But
I'm hoping somebody makes it somewhere in the top 32 cut, because that'll make it a lot easier to figure out who went the furthest than saying first in group versus second in group based off of wins. Because
whatever, the AC regulars are going to win the whole thing or make it really easy.
Yeah. So the AC regulars, which includes Z here, they have 5 wins, which only put them third in their group.
Third in the group, which is frustrating when I see that there was a 5 win first in groups. Like, dang it. Like, I was just in the wrong group.
Yep. So they're still fighting. And as I understand, you guys you've got your first win on your playing match.
I did win my match. My opponent had 25 creatures and I had a Quixel Stone. I played it on turn 3 and said GG. Not really. I don't do that.
So, yeah, you guys,
definitely over.
What was it? Was this week 74 or 72?
This was 74.
Okay.
Although my deck is a 70.
I know in that 74 range, you own some really silly stuff.
Yes. This was a good week for me.
So, but
finally.
But the next week drops back down to 72.
And then I'm screwed again. Oh, wait, 70. No, it goes to 70.
70.
Right.
Okay.
Yeah. Yeah.
So that's interesting, because now you got to go back to those mediocre whatever decks.
Yeah, this is not my realm. I've struggled in a lot of cases. I've been using Tolker's decks because he has a ton of these. So been interesting.
Okay, then easier from the bottom. They got 3 wins and did not make it to the top 32 cut. But good effort. And then there was the Grump Buggy Brewers, which includes me, and we're hiding under a rock.
Yeah,
because we got smashed by it.
What, did they announce next, like COAT 9?
So COAT 9, if you are a Patreon backer, they have announced what COAT 9 is going to be. I am a Patreon backer of theirs. I know what it is, but I'm actually not dirty enough to spoil their fun.
Rare honorable moment, Marman Dan.
Yeah. So next week you will all hear about from the COAT cast nice. what it is. It's pretty cool. I like what it is.
All right. Well, then that probably bodes well for me, unless it's about to be all AOA, which would be horrible.
No, it's definitely not AOA. It's got stuff. I think you'll be fine with it.
Okay. Because, I mean, y'all know that listen to this regularly that I almost did not play. And I said, but then Dan did his contacts with AC regulars. Like, someone dings me, I'll be happy for these.
I don't know. I have to find something else, but I will probably do something similar for Coat 9 again.
All right. Now I will look forward to seeing what you come up with. All right, so here is our warning time. We are about to head into Set 5 Dark Tidings, Shadows, Spoilers. So if you are not into spoilers, we do appreciate you listening today. Please tune in again next week, but here come the spoilers from Shadows, Dark Tidings, Set 5.
It's been a lot of hate for Shadows.
There's been a lot of hate ever since Coda for Shadows, because in my opinion, it has progressively gotten pretty much worse every set.
Yeah, I've gone out of my way to find my 4 Ronnie Wrist Clock decks to make
it okay. Like there has been stuff in every Shadows set I think almost redeem it, but in a set comparatively to what it was, like it's in a way like I was almost in that with Untamed, but I think inside of each set, I found enough high-end Untamed stuff that I just didn't think was going to come together to redeem it. But I really can't say the same about Shadows all the time. So it's like, okay, like, did you get TMTP in your deck with the other 10 bad cards? Like,
yeah, so TMTP is a huge thing, but I don't know if you crack random Coda anymore. Shadows is often thoroughly underwhelming.
Because of the nature of the game and the stuff that we're seeing, I do have to agree with you. I kind of talked to this about someone one-on-one this week, actually. Like, steal one on 4 common cards in a deck, which is what we saw a ton of in Shadows Coda, isn't going to do it. Like, especially when you have, like, multiple Eddie decks with graphs that set it up. Tribute 6 Emperor in a deck with archiving. Like, there are so many swingy things, even in MM, while they can easily be dealt with, if you don't answer Envy Gluttony, you just gonna lose. Like, like it's the game is over. Like, they will take all you got every turn and it's gonna be done. Like, there's just so many things that are more powerful, like the bait and switch thing ever was. That are hard to deal with. Like, we've been seeing the KFPL, there's multiple AOA decks that can, like, recur and kill Brend every third turn or something. It's just like, there he is again. Oh, he's dead again. You lose more Amber. Like, there's just things out there. And that is actually in Shadows, but again, that's not like Nerve Blast Urchin, Relentless Whispers, or the worst version of the game later. Like, it's combo stuff. That's where it's at. That is winning game way more than the incremental ping steal. And that's all that Coda was. Although it did also have TP. So there's that. All right, let's get into it though. So we're going to do this like we did last week because that worked pretty well. Dan is going to start with our 7 evils one at a time. I'm going to tell you their non-evil equivalents. We're going to try not to say the word good. Some of them aren't good. All right. Mm. All right. Yeah. Let's start us off.
All right. First one is Captain Nobeard, an elf thief, 6 power taunter who says destroyed each of Captain Nobeard's neighbors. Capture 1.
Capture. When he's destroyed. Like, I love taunt. Everyone knows I love taunt. So, like, just the fact that he's a 6 power with taunt. I do like that, but the destroyed effect is not great.
Mediocre.
I would probably be happy if it's common, but since I'm the one looking at the normalized version, this is a rare creature. So if I'm getting a rare card in a deck, this is sure not what I want.
It could be worse. It could be Perspective Grammar Bot or Briar Grublings. I mean, like,
I definitely don't want a Briar Grubbling, but the Grammar Mod, I would be. All right, the Captain Nobeard normal. 3 power, so he lost power. 0 armor, still elf, rare, as I said. Each of Captain Nobeard's neighbors gains taunt and reap capture 1. I think that is significantly better, right? You're giving something else taunt, which could be anything, which there that means in itself there are some interesting things that can happen. And that automatically gives them an Amber Control effect that is not in this house. So you could say give one of your fish creatures some Amber Control because the fish don't have a lot of it.
Yes. I mean, like, yeah. So reap Amber Control, real good, right? Because you are both progressing your game forward.
Yeah.
And
it turns its neighbor into a champion in Alfeos last time. It's pretty good.
It's okay.
I mean, it's better than the other one.
Okay. All right.
I don't know if it's above average value. Yeah. All right. Who we got next?
Next up, we have the Freebooter Fae. He's a 4-power elf thief. He's got a play effect of Raise the Tide. And then if the tide is high, before fight, if the tide is high, steal one. Okay. So, I mean, like, fight steal is good, right? Like, that, or, fight, I mean, is okay. Steal, yeah. But this
so
is actually
before
fight.
This is better than, like, Dodger. Like, he's way better than Dodger. Yeah, right?
I mean, he's guaranteed to get the steal, right? Where Dodger sometimes just had to fight into something.
He has one less power, but he's guaranteed to get the steal. Yeah. And he raises the tide.
Yeah, the raise the tide on play really puts the value on this.
Mm-hmm.
And what is this guy?
So this is an uncommon creature.
Okay.
The normal version is 4-power, 0-armor, still elf thief. On play, still raises the tide. Reap. Steal if the tide is high. Okay, so the normal version is way, way better.
Okay, so 2 for 2, we want normal decks. Which...
So let's talk about this real quick. Like, this is actually a really good card, right? Because, like, Gamgee kind of sucks because it doesn't trigger that often.
Yeah, because they have to have more Amber than you.
Right? And then if you look at another one that has this effect, Drekker pretty much auto-dies for no reason.
Well, like, Drekker dies because he has a crappy ability that makes him die easy, but
yeah.
I...
Because, like, they'll fight into a 2-power or something, and they'll kill him, their guy lives, all kinds of... Like,
was that in the KFPL? Where somewhere recently I had to play against a triple Decker recursion ability to fire them things, and it was good.
Oh, did they have Essence Scale? Because Essence Scale will make Drekker real good.
Yeah, like, Drekkers are good, even with their bad ability of they die when their neighbor gets punched.
Well, and all that saying, like, this guy is better than Gamgee and Drekker by a large margin.
Yeah. Play raise.
One raises your tide, and then if you don't kill him immediately, and there's not easy to kill like Drekker, you're going to pay the price, and they're going to start climbing Amber real fast.
And as an uncommon, you could have 3 of them.
Yeah, you could have up to 3. Lots of decks will have 2, and a ton of decks will have 1. So I'm definitely liking the normal version first so far. So let's go on. Who's next?
Okay, next up is Hard Simpson, who is a 4-power, no armor elf thief. And he says, reap, if the tide is high, a damaged creature captures one from its own side. Okay, so this is a mind warper, right?
It is a mind warper, but it has to be damaged. And if they don't have a damaged creature, this is not a may. So if you have a damaged creature and they don't, you're not gaining amber.
Yeah, then you're not reaping because it's bad.
Yeah. Yeah, it's real bad. So I don't like that. So let's talk about...
It's not thrilling.
It's not thrilling. So let's talk about the normal version. It is a common. So you're going to see lots of these. Elf Thief, still 4-power. This one is elusive. It's not. After Hard Simpson is dealt damage, steal 1. If the tide is low, your opponent steals 1. Mm-hmm. Hard Simpson must survive this damage. So... can't kill them and trigger.
He's
4-power. So if you can somehow deal 3 damage to him.
If you can continually ping him, like, so I raise the tide and then I ping him. If I have a deck that has pingy effects, you know, ping, steal, ping, steal, ping, steal.
Yeah.
Terrible.
I don't like either version, guys. I think they're both bad.
Yeah.
I think the evil one is better. This one is abusable in the right deck. If you have a lot of ways to deal 1 damage, then that means you have to have, what, 4 cards in it? Even that doesn't sound good. Like,
I don't know.
I hate this version. And this uncommon means you're going to see 2, 3, 4, 5. Like, Well, at least you can sell that to Dave. But anyway, not great.
For
not...
less than you paid for the deck to open it.
I mean, I guess there's a scenario if you do have a whole bunch of them and then a way to deal everyone one damage. That's something, right? I don't know. We'll see. What's next?
So the next one is called, we think, the Hobnobber, although his name in whatever language this card was Fraternizer, which is a better name. He is a 3-power, 0 armor, elf thief, and his is Omni. If your opponent has exactly 1 amber, deal
it. All right, I kind of like this because I always enjoyed Ghostly Hand and being so happy when it triggered. So, like, on a personal level,
I hate Ghostly Hand because it never triggers. But
I don't know. I played a couple of decks that got it blocked. Like we said, or said earlier, it did have a lot of that incremental steal. Yeah. And now that I'm less excited about incremental steal, it's probably less good than it was. But from like a sentimental value, I kind of like that. Let's see what this card. Oh, go ahead.
But as an Omni ability, it's pretty good because any turn you get them to 1, you can then fire this, and then on your Shadow's turns, he can reap. So I mean, like, he is a mediocre.
Yeah, like if you have one of those Sanctum lines we talked about, they captured a lot.
Yeah.
This could allow you to capture him down to 1 quite often, actually. Fire him. I think it does generate a bit more threat than most Shadow cards would draw. It's not going to draw as much hate as, like, Mac the Knife, because he's just not as good as Mac. Anywhere close to as good as Mac, but I think it should draw a lot of hate. The normal version is a common, so you will see a lot of these. That actually makes me like it a little less. You don't want a whole bunch of these. You only steal 1. The common version is also 3-power, still elf thief, has an action. If your opponent has 6 or more, steal 2 amber. This is a common card. That feels real good.
So yes? I'm thinking there is a... there's the little creature that loses elusive, and that's action steal 2, right? In Mass Mutation.
That's a 1-power.
Well, and that's not a bad card. Like, it requires you to deal with it.
Yeah, that, but with it only having 1 power, it's easy to deal with because in MM, that's just like 1 card that has a pip or whatever.
But, and this one, so they gotta be at, like, they didn't set it for 7, so all they gotta do is be at check, and then action steal 2.
Yeah, the fact that it's 6 or more, like if this was 7 or more, it would be way worse.
Yeah, but like way easier to play around.
But at 6 or more, like you've got to cut, like most decks have to go to 6 to forge keys, right? This is a must address. This is, I think, pretty close to witch level must address. And at 3-power, again, this is like the same kind of effort that goes into this. And this is common. So again, I think I'm swinging in toward the common pretty hard. As of right now, the only common that I don't like is only Shadow's regular card I don't like is the Hard Simpson one. All right, what's next?
Yeah, okay, so the next one is called Monty Bank. Is another elf thief. He is a 1-power, 0 armor creature. He has elusive. This one. He says play, exalt this creature twice, action, steal 1. For each amber on this creature.
This sounds just like a way worse version of what we read.
If
right?
this card had play
more
slash
power
action,
or something, I don't know.
Even if it just had play slash action, it would be tolerable. But as a 1-power creature, he just seems so bad to me. So I'm going to exalt him twice. You're going to kill him before I get to action with him. So play this creature, give your opponent 2 amber.
This is, I don't know what to say. This is so bad. This is a discard most of the time.
Yeah. Now, like, is there some dream where you stack more amber on this and action steal for 7?
The same turn you played him? No.
Well, I said there's like, a dream. It's not a
I mean,
good
what?
One.
Legacy speeds? Like, that's the only scenario.
So
we all talked about how Speed Sigil is almost unplayable against MM and Worlds Collide anyway. So
no, this card is bad.
Yeah, this is real bad. This is like Pit Lord level. Like, it's not good.
Yeah.
It's all right. So
his normalized version is also bad. as ever.
Okay, let's see. Monty Bank, normal. It's an uncommon, so you won't see too many of these. Still one power, zero armor. The normal version is not elusive, so lost that. On play, you may exalt Monty Bank up to 2 times, so that did not change. Actions.
It's a may, so it got better. Oh,
okay, so you don't have to. Weird. Action. You steal one amber for each amber on Monty Bank. So the action
didn't change. Could you say it again?
Steal one amber for each amber on Monty Bank.
That's the exact same action. Action. Steal one for each amber on this creature.
So the only difference is it loses elusive and does not have to exalt.
So I like
still
it better.
Bad, but you can play it sometimes.
Yeah, so, like, well, you can play.
Always play it. There's never reason. Well, I guess there are reasons, but you can play it way more often than the other one. This is a card you just don't want in your deck, people. Like this is like bad penny level draw of getting a card in your deck. Probably worse than bad penny because you could actually do something with bad penny in most decks. All right, what's next? So this is no one wants this card in their deck.
Okay, One-Eyed Willa. 2 power, 0 armor. I think probably Elf Thief again, but it didn't get translated. It's got elusive and skirmish. Boy. Fight. If the tide is high, your opponent loses 2. So fight, lose 2 on a skirmish creature. Seems
so it's
fine.
Kind of like Umbra? Like you don't steal one, but they lose 2? It is elusive. So like probably worse than Umbra, maybe better in some cases. I don't know. Yeah, very Umbra-like.
There hasn't been a lot of steel hate, or has there been a lot of steel hate in this set?
I can't remember if we saw Vault Keeper or not. I think we did.
I think we saw Vault Keeper. I don't think we saw a Discombobulator, but don't quote me on that, folks.
Yeah.
I mean, that's just one of those places where this is okay. But fight, lose 2 on a skirmish creature, like...
That's pretty good. Like, that part's good. The fact that it has elusive and Umbra didn't, like, it's hard for me to say it's actually better or worse than Umbra without having played it. I think it's very similar. I kind of hate Umbra because it always died, yeah. But being elusive does matter because I have had lots of people just fight and kill Umbra and then
kick Umbra in the teeth.
Yep.
But all right. Well, tell me about normal.
Normal version. Still, it is an Elf Thief. That's confirmed. It is a common card. One-Eyed Willa is a 2 power, 0 armor. That did not change. While the tide is high, One-Eyed Willa gains elusive and skirmish and then gets fight, steal 1. So when the tide is high, gets the elusive in the skirmish, it always has fight, steal 1. I need to clarify what I said.
Okay, so it is...
So it's a 2 power fight Umbra. Steal 1 that gains Umbra skirmish and then added elusive when tide is high. So it's.
But that means in a regular Dark Tidings match, they take the tide away and it's just a crummy Umbra.
So Dark Tidings versus Dark Tidings, this is definitely worse than Umbra. In offset play, this is just slightly better than Umbra. I am more entertained and intrigued by the dark one here. Although I think mathematically they are almost the same value card. So, doesn't matter which one you have. They're both common. You're going to see a lot.
All right. Just well, like and here's the one everybody's been talking about.
Yes,
it is.
This is a big one.
Sea Urchin, 1 power, 0 armor, Aquian Thief. Ah, the first non-elf thief in these. And it says, play, capture 2. If the tide is high, steal 2 instead. So, basically, play steel 2.
This is a common card. People have kind of been talking about this one. The math behind this in an Infernus land gameplay area, which is not DT, like it's not in set play, but normal world, you'll see a ton of Infernus. In my opinion, 3 sea urchins is already better than 4 routine jobs. If you're actually looking about the way the game is played. So that's pretty dang good.
Well, I mean, like, there's bounce and stuff to make him replay, too.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so that's why I'm saying, like, even without the bounce, though, I think just the being able to steal 6 from hand, not be diminished by Infernus, I think you're already in that 4 routine job land of, like, this is the impact you're going to have in the game. And that's, and even though it's one power, it's probably just going to die. It still is putting a creature on the board. So there's even a small chance you'll get to reap with them later.
So we want a deck that is full of Freebooter Phase and Sea Urchin so we can raise the tide for free and steal all their money.
Yeah. Give me five evil urchins. It is a common. And none of the other evil dudes, other than maybe, actually, yeah, I could take like five Sea Urchins, one or two Freebooter Phase, and we can just go about our merry stealing everything under the sun.
Yeah. All right, well, tell me about the normal version.
Normal one. Common creature, already said, Aquan Thief, still one power, still not elusive. It has poison, because we all care about a one power creature with poison. On play, capture one. If the tide is high, steal one. It's basically a crappy urchin. Most of the time, you will steal one on play. It will have poison with only one power. It will hardly ever matter.
I don't know. That one power poison, like, there are a lot of big boys in this set.
But a lot of them have one armor.
In Unfathomable, that do not have armor.
That's true.
But, clearly, we want evil.
But then if you're playing, if you're playing against MM, just a damage pip. Like, it's one power creatures don't ever live anymore. There was a ton of one damage stuff in AOA. Like, it's just a thing.
No, it's definitely not good.
No.
And then he has to sacrifice himself, so he fails to reap to pick something up.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. So when our evil twin version versus the common version, here's my notes. Basically, you want the common version of a Shadows deck, unless you can get three or more Sea Urchins. If you have a deck with three or more Sea Urchins, you definitely want the evil one.
And my opinion is, unless you got a bunch of evil Sea Urchins, you don't want Shadows.
Yeah, because even the common, like the normal version of these aren't the greatest cards. They're just cards that all have a lot of incremental amber control. And we literally just talked about how that has become way more underwhelming than it ever was.
And it's before. All slow, too. It's play, then do something later.
Yeah, before fight, etc.
Okay, so moving on, we got the previously spoiled ship, which is the Archon's Revenge. This is their house ship, and it says, action, exhaust up to two friendly Shadows creatures. For each creature exhausted this way, steal one. Now, on the other hand, being how crappy some of these creatures' abilities were, this ship makes them slightly better.
I think this is definitely one of the better ships. There's very few artifacts in the game that are going to do anything close to that. It's like starting to not be true, but this is an effective artifact. It create like all of these things that like kind of have play effects and then they're done, all of a sudden have a new level of relevance. So that's kind of neat.
Yeah, it is probably my favorite ship, but still not a fan of it.
No. All right, looks like I got card 193, Dead Man's Chest. It is a rare artifact. On play, get an amber. It is a treasure. Play, put 4 amber on Dead Man's Chest from the supply. Deal 2 damage to a creature. If 6 or more creatures are destroyed during a turn and Dead Man's Chest is ready, move all amber from Dead Man's Chest to the active player's pool. This is an interesting one. So, like, this is one you could make sure that, I don't know. Nope. It doesn't have to be your creatures.
No, but your opponent always gets first chance on this. Because you play it in exhausted, they get first chance to clear the board and steal that amber, or take that amber. I mean, if there's no creatures in play, it's not such a big deal.
I think out of all of the chest treasures that we've looked at so far, this is the one that is probably the most likely guaranteed to trigger in most games.
Yes.
And I think at some point in the game, in almost every game, there will be 6 creatures destroyed in a single turn. Because it doesn't matter which side. Like, so if 2 creatures fight each other and die, that's 2 already, right? Like, this happens in most games. And and we talked about this a lot. And a lot of the ones that we were talking about, like, this one's really easy to control. This one's easy to check their deck to see if they can even do this ever. That is not the case for this one. This is going to happen. Like, so you need to try to figure out if your deck is regularly on the side to make that. This is one of those that when you're looking at their deck list, like, I don't even know how you do that. Like, that would be a lot to check for in a 2-minute window when there's more important things you need to be checking for.
I mean, if they have a board wipe, you can assume they can fire it, right? Because they play a few creatures and then blow up the board and say, hey, I'll take that.
So this is, I think, probably the most dangerous card. One of the treasures. There's one in all the houses. This is the most dangerous one.
Made this one of the easier ones to play because you get an amber and you get to do 2 damage to a creature, which may be a big deal.
Yep.
So that's interesting. Like
it's dangerous. Like that's a hard one. I think this is going to get played by a lot of people and then immediately triggered by their.
Yeah. This is going to be one of our cards. You could lose it for playing this card.
Yes, that goes straight on the list. Like you could lose games by playing this card pretty highly frequently.
All right.
Debno's back. Yep. You got early bird.
All right. Early birds. Oh, yeah, this one. Okay. Alpha. Play, ready each shadow creature. So the interesting part is it has 2 amber pips on it, so most likely you get 2 amber when you play it. As an alpha card, then ready each shadows card. So this is just a counter to some of
the fish
actions. So you can ready your bad shadows cards.
Yeah, this is really weird. It's really just a counter card. Not even a hard counter. It's just a counter to the fish house and some of the earlier untamed actions that we saw a long time ago, like persistence hunting and nocturnal maneuver.
Okay.
That is it. Like nothing else. It's like those 2 cards in untamed and then the fish house.
So basically you're talking about a card that is 2 amber.
On alpha, printed at rare. So you're not likely to ever get more than 1 of them. Thank goodness. God. Yeah. Like, if this was printed at common, this would be one of the worst cards in the set. Fuck! Like, we already saw that a long time ago. Like, Glimmer is a great card in a very few select decks. Yeah. It is also completely trash in all of the... Like, because you get 5
of them. I'm not, by any means, that card just says, hey, Infernus, eat me.
Infernus is not going away in popularity. It doesn't matter that it does not in set 5. It's one of the most played cards out of set 3 and 4, and those are very, very good sets. This is furnace food, right? Unless you're playing, like, I think it's relatively relevant inside of sealed play, inside of Dark Tidings.
Oh yeah.
So that, like, because 2 amber from hand is always 2 amber. So like, the only time I'd be happy to see this card is Tidings play. All right, looks like I have easy marks. It is a rare action. On play, exalt each damaged enemy creature. Could be good, could be worthless. It's
a combo card, right? Could be bad.
Yeah, it could be real bad. Yeah, it could be real bad.
I'm fine with it being a rare, like, because it is an interesting card that could be good or could be bad, but you're not going to be stuck with a lot of them. And it does only target enemy creatures, which makes it so much nicer.
All right, then Finch Cloak, Finishing Blow, Mac the Knife, Master Mindy, Master Plan, Mole, Ransom, Ring of Invisibility, Sack of Coins, Scally Capers, Smiling Roof. That was sad. Are all back.
Ransom's a new card.
Oh, is it?
Yeah.
Yes, it is. My bad. So I'm sorry. Those other ones are back. Ransom, Dan's and Tacos.
Ransom says this creature, so it's an upgrade, right? And says this creature cannot be used, and it gains at the start of your turn. You may give your opponent 2 amber. If you do, destroy Ransom. So that's not 2 from the common pool. That's like steal, but it's not steal because it's give. Thank you for the gift.
It's basically destroy a creature. Because in most cases, I think they're just never going to do this.
Right. They're just going to ignore that.
Because it's not one of those, like, if you have low amber, you can get rid of it, like a Brabble or something. If you don't have 2 amber, you can't do this. Like Custom Depot style. Or Customs Office, or whatever. Like, if you don't have the amount to pay, you cannot do it. This is more or less a destroy any creature from hand most of the time.
Sort of. Access denied and its counterpart are considered decent cards, and this is in that mm-hmm. same kind of vein.
Yeah, it's decent. I think when they do pay it, they will probably be getting some kind of huge value off of it. It'll just be steel too.
Yeah.
But like, but when you're talking about a card that's either destroy a creature or steal two, you're talking about a pretty good card, right?
So here's the thing though. If you want to be a jerk player, you play Ransom, they start their turn, they play a card, and they go, oh, I want to Ransom this card. And you go, no, you had to do that at the start of your turn. Sorry.
Well, TCO will address that, but in live play, yes, as soon as you've picked a house, you can no longer pay the Ransom.
Right. So, and I think that is one of those triggers that we missed a mm-hmm. lot.
Yes, it is for sure. In local, like, I definitely think I would.
I mean, or use a different card, I would probably be like, whatever.
Yeah. Yeah, sure.
But if it was for first in a Vault Tour Warrior, I might be a Jagoff. Might be that guy.
If Vault Warrior ever comes a thing, that is a different thing altogether. I don't think anyone should even be asking to take stuff back Vault Warrior. But like, I do like where the Vaults have kind of positioned themselves as that like transition from casual to premier, but you still see both players. Knowing that, I would probably even let them take it back in a Vault. But day two of a Vault, probably not. Like, it's a little different once you get to day two.
Okay, so
tell us what's coming back. Oh no, we already did. That means I'm on Submersible.
Okay.
It's a ship. Oh, this is the house that has like three ships, right? Submersible. Okay. It's an artifact rare. It's a ship on play. You get an amber. While the tide is high, each friendly thief creature gains elusive.
So because tide is easy to take away, it's a dumb card.
Especially when it matters, yeah. Like, so this is really bad in set.
I mean, like, it's just a crappy amber-pipped artifact, which, God knows, there is plenty of them in every set. So, it's a... I think it's just a who-cares card. Like, you're not... It's on rare.
It's on rare. You're not going
to
see
enough of them to care about.
Excited.
Yeah, it's just... At least it has an amber pip, so...
All right, Shadow Council's back. That's their leader. And then you get the next
one. All right, next one is called Widespread Corruption. A rare artifact. It gives you an amber. It's of the type power. And then it says, after a player gains amber by reaping, their opponent captures that amber onto a creature they control.
So it turns all Maro's? Things... Maro's? Yeah, yeah. It turns... The Sir Maro's effect is always in play both sides.
Yes, you're right. This is a two-sided effect.
I don't like this. This doesn't seem to go with Shadows. Like this should have been like a Sanctum artifact or a Saurian artifact or not a Shadows artifact.
Now just think about a bunch of Playsteel creatures, and then in Shadows this set, there's been a few reap something, but they're almost all fight before fight action. And
I mean, I could see it more if there was like a TMTP in set. We haven't gone through the set yet, but spoiler, it's not
there.
Like, that is the only thing that would save this card in my mind, and it's not there. I don't like this. I don't like this in this house. I'll say that. I'm going to reserve judgment on whether I think it's a good or bad card, because there's a lot of these that I said a long time ago I'm going to try to stop doing that. Like, I need to play this card, and just like I had to play Curia out and see what's going on there, and I have to see what's going on here. But like, without a way to punish the capture at the end of the day, it's not really doing that much. Like, it's just delay.
Maybe it's okay with a dino stack where you can actually something with amber.
We talked about how Doorstep was in set, so I guess if you also have Sanctum in your deck, which is why this should just have been a Sanctum card. Like, it's like, I don't know. All right. Looks like I've got Blatant Thievery. Uncommon action. Gives you an amber, one raw amber. On play, enrage an enemy creature. Move all amber from that creature to your pool. Now, this card is really damn good.
Yeah, like, that card is absolutely bonkers offset and still very good inset.
Like, even back in set one, there were situations like, you know, Old Bruno was a thing, Tourette was a thing, Gatekeeper was still there. Like, there's always been several iterations of the game where tons of decks you play against have piles of Ambrons. And we all know Worlds Collide, there's a freaking ton of that. Even in Mim, you got like Anthony's, all that. Like, I like this card. This works.
I mean, this card just like takes Calliope and Ideal decks and kicks them right in their cookies.
Yep. Oh, you want to like tribute onto your Scootum or whatever? Oh, I'm just going to take it back. Yeah. Now you guys mad at me.
This card seems like it's potentially super good.
Yeah.
Timing based, like everything, but potentially super good.
Yes, and it's uncommon, so you'll see 1, 2, possibly 3. Booby Trap's back, Borrow's back, lots of people will be glad about that. Yep. Brenn the Frenetic, and like we got an upgrade, Dan, what does this do?
Alright, our next one is called Hand Cannon, uncommon upgrade, and it says, gain an amber when you play it, and then this creature gains skirmish, and fight, move one amber from the creature, this creature fights to your pool. So this is another one where you get to take amber off their creatures.
Yep.
It makes a guy skirmishy. I mean, like, this is fine.
I don't know. I like the Blatant Thievery a lot better than this. Like, this is kind of... this is literally just a slightly upgraded Way of the Wolf from a long time ago. I mean, that was a fine upgrade. This is it does kind of combo with our the normal Freebooter Fae dude, so that's cool. Oh no, the dark one. It combos with the dark one.
The only thing I can say about these cards is they're just letting you get amber back that is sort of yours anyways without having to kill creatures.
Yeah.
Right? Like, in a way, that amber is yours and you should get it back someday anyways. And these are just letting you do that, but leave the creatures on the board. And I don't know if I really like that much. Like, I think of this in comparison to Sirenhorn, and I think I like Sirenhorn.
I would still rather have the original, like the Ring of Invisibility from way back. Like, that's a fine upgrade. It's not great. It's not horrible. It's completely average kind of. Oh, it's actually in set. So it's
okay. But,
all right. Anyway, Little Nymph is back. Meowth's Bomb is back. Old Bruno's back. Just talked about him. Ransack's coming back from set 4. So that leaves me with Safe or Sorry. This is our first... Is this the only one? This is our first Ore card in Shadows. It's an uncommon action. On play, you do not gain an amber, but you choose one. Archive any number of friendly creatures from play. We already talked about all the play effects. Or choose a creature. Deal one to that creature for each amber your opponent has in their... All right, so I think this is the first one where, like, I think it's hard to say which one's going to be used the most.
Well, it depends if this is in your Evil Twin 5.
Oh, yeah. Like, here's my 5 sea urchins, and then I'm going to play safe. That's the first part.
Yeah.
I'm going to archive all of them. What's super important, I think, to put in information out there for this is it combos with stuff we already know exists. There's tons of play stuff that we've already talked about in all of the houses we talked about it. And this has archived any number of friendly creatures from play. So most of the time, like Mind Over Matter, Hysteria, it's all or nothing, right?
Yeah.
In this scenario, you're like, okay, I'm going to pick up this, 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 and this on play creature and leave the rest there. I don't think we really have an analogous card to this.
No, and it even puts them in the archives, which is...
Yeah, that's what I'm saying. Like, because even Nature's Call, like, you're forced to put them back in your hand. So, like, if your Nature's Calling, like, off-house, obviously you're not drawing and you're paying for that. Like, I think this card, which I haven't actually heard anybody talk about this, it's literally the first time I'm reading this card. This creates a lot of, like, weird scenarios that could be very good.
Now, right,
didn't we say Architect is in the set already? Like, we covered that. Yeah. So that's another way to get the Architect in there. Like, it's very interesting.
It could be very good, and there'll also be times when you play this for
damage thing, yeah.
For a little bit of damage, in theory. Yeah. So
the sorry right, part is
the second part, all that damage gets dealt at once, right? That's how they've ruled these cards.
All of it at once.
It's not one at a time. If it was one at a time, this card would be better.
Yes.
But it's not.
It would be a little better.
I mean, so it's a reverse Sakakone.
I am excited about this card, though. I am excited. Like, I was fairly underwhelmed about Shadows, to be honest. But I think there are definitely some stuff that I could see that involve this card and some of the on-play Shadows lines. And more importantly, the on-play other cards and other houses that could do some interesting things. Because you're going to see this just as often as Nature's Call. It's uncommon.
I mean, even this card, say for Sari, in a deck with even regular Sea Urchins is pretty good, right? If it's steal one, like, stick them all back away.
If they're all stealing one, and you're immediately... Yeah, especially if you have like two of them. You do that two turns in a row. That's steal six. Like, it's significant.
Yep, that card seems good. All right, so the next one is called Stir Up Trouble. This is an uncommon action, and it says, play, choose a creature and one of its neighbors. Each chosen creature deals damage equal to its power to the other. So you get two guys to fight each other.
Seems funny.
Seems
Seems
like I put my one power creature that doesn't matter next to my important creature, and it does nothing.
Like a potentially better Mighty Lance at its best, at its worst, it does almost nothing. So, I don't know. That's my only comment.
I mean, like, you want to say it's targeted creature control, but it's not guaranteed targeted creature control.
No. And the more common or at the higher level, it'll be no play around. It's like a lot of the high players do play around the group think tanks, etc. Like, I don't know. All right, looks like I got the third ship. The Flying Spectre is an artifact uncommon ship. After your opponent raises the tide, destroy the Flying Spectre. So they have to, if at any time your opponent raises the tide, this card is gone. Action, steal one if the tide is high.
So, garbage?
Yeah, like that doesn't sound good. If you're playing inset DT versus DT, it is just a card in your deck. Chain, I guess. If you're playing offset, it might steal one out of five games you play. Like, I don't know.
It's slow too, right? Like, I gotta play it, then I gotta look at you and be like, you want to destroy my Flying Spectre? No?
Yeah.
Well, hopefully I have more Shadows cards, because otherwise I ain't doing much. Action, steal one.
I definitely feel like the artifact probably should have been ready, but
that anyway. Card seems bad.
All right. Backer.
Okay. The next one is Trickle Down Theory. It is an artifact uncommon. Power. Play. Raise the tide. That's always good. Omni effect. Wow. Gain one amber if your opponent has six or more.
This is real good. This is uncommon. So, like, if I have one of these, you're going to gain 2 to 3 amber a game if you played early. But at uncommon, assuming they didn't lock this card down, you can have 2 or 3 of these in a deck. If you, like, and obviously you have Shadows in your deck, so if you can stall them, right, in the same set that does have Eddie and some untamed stuff that we haven't talked about yet that can raise our key costs, like, this could be, like, I'm gaining 2 to 3 amber every single turn.
Yeah, the fact that it's Omni... I'm surprised this is Omni, to tell you the truth.
The fact that it's Omni and it does have Flay Raise the Tide attached to it as well.
Yeah.
Like, this is a really valuable uncommon slot artifact.
I mean, I like this with, like, Brend. Like, oh, you went to 5? Well, here's 6 with Brend. I will now take everything. Oh, and then I'm going to shoot my Brend.
Yeah, Brend is in set. Yeah. Like, there's a lot of potential in this card. I like this. This is pretty strong.
Yeah, this seems good. There's nothing wrong
with it. We already talked about the one that's steal 2 if they're at 6, right?
Yep.
On play. So yeah, I'm going to put you at 6, then play that, steal 2. Like, it's... never mind. Bren puts them on 6, then all of this happens. Yeah, there's some definitely combo potential with these uncommon cards. Most of those aren't common, so there won't be as kind of... Whispers back. I don't remember. Mine.
All right. Now, Cement Shoes, next card. A common action. So this is our first common action. So we'll see a bunch of these. It's got an amber pip on it. And then it says, play, deal 2 damage to a creature. If this damage destroys that creature, raise the tide. Okay, so Pip of Amber, that's fine. 2 damage, mediocre. But if it kills it, you get to raise the tide.
And if it's Bren, you get to steal.
Yeah. I bet it wasn't 3 damage.
Yeah, 3 damage would have been pretty awesome.
This card seems fine. Like, how do you... I mean, like, it's right in line with the effects of Mug.
Yeah. It's worse than Mug, but yes, it is around that. Like, all Shadow sets have a card that does 2 damage.
I don't know, like, take 1 Amber off a creature versus prevent me from having to gain 3 chains, potentially? I don't know.
True. This does actually sound like, out of all of the sets that we've covered so far, I've seen a lot of Raise the Tide, right? Like, this feels like a lot.
Like, does feel
the artifact does it, there's the common that does it, there's this that does it, is also on common. Like, that's a bit. Okay, so
Francis is back.
The Economist normally sucks, but is he, like, so I'm gonna pause. We normally don't go over, like, cards are coming back. Is he better in this set? We talked about a, like, gain 1 when they're at 6, steal 2 when they're at 6. Brend is back.
There does seem to be a bit more that has to go, like, along with Amber count on them. But no, Francis is still bad.
Okay. Well, that got it. I knew that. I don't know. I figured that was the answer, but I'm just saying
there are more situations
there
where
are
you
more
can...
ways to implement him than there were.
Right.
Still bad though.
Don't like him. Yeah.
All right. So I have Gas Pipes Malone. That's a fun name. Common creature, 3 power, 0 armor, elf thief. Before fight, the creature Gas Pipe Malone fights captures 1 from its own side. Kind of like it. It's like a little, I don't know, weird.
He doesn't have skirmish, so he's bad. Now, on the other hand, a Gas Pipe Malone.
If he has the hand cannon.
Yeah, upgraded with a hand cannon, now you got a card.
Yeah. Yeah, he's weird. He's not great.
Yeah, I mean, like, he's not terrible either, because he can, it is before fight, so it's a guaranteed thing. Like, if you need to just take 1 amber away from them, this guy can still do it. Right?
And it is also important to note that the way this is written does get around steal hate, because you are technically kind of stealing it from them.
Yes.
But it doesn't use that word, so there is that.
All right, next card that we're talking about is Hornswoggle. or a common action, has an amber pip. There are a lot of amber pips, it feels like, on common here. So get your amber and then play, use an enemy artifact as if it were yours. So,
it's remote access.
Yes.
Okay.
And remote access is fine.
Yes. Yes.
So this
it's
card
fine.
Is fine.
Yes.
Okay.
All right. Then we have another common creature, Jackie Tar, 2 power, 0 armor, another elf thief. This one is elusive. On reap, deal 1 damage to a creature. If the tide is high, deal 6 damage to a creature. So this is kind of like Bullet Eye ish.
Kind of like Bullet Eye. Sure.
I liked Bullet Eye just fine.
I was going to say, so I like
Jackie Tar just fine.
I like the upgrade that said, you know, the Shadows of Coda upgrade that made him do 2 or 4 damage
silent,
on reap.
Silent Dagger. Yeah, Silent Dagger. That was like, fun.
That was a good enough card. Like, this is.
I think this is like about as close to an average card in Q4 as you.
I mean, 6 damage takes care of a lot of problems.
Mm-hmm.
So.
And it's a 2 power with elusive, so can be dealt with, but it's not going to be like 1 pipped from MM.
Yeah, and unlike some of the other ones, this doesn't say some of those other shadows effect. This doesn't require flank or anything silly. Mm-hmm. You can just pick something, blow it up. So this card's okay. Okay, so next up we got Kerwallop, a common action that says play, deal 1 damage to each creature. Gain 1 amber for each creature destroyed this way.
This feels kind of good, right?
Feels interesting. It's 1 damage to everything. And then
every gain... creature, both sides.
Right, so
there's
this
a lot
is...
of creatures that have 1 on your side.
This is throwing stars that throws
this is
at
like
everybody.
Pumped up throwing stars.
Yeah, machine gun throwing stars.
There are definitely games where this card can be like cleansing wavelength.
Well, it makes the guy who lets you steal for taking damage a little better. Like
I will throw that out there. We talked about the Heart Symptom, and I don't like Heart Symptom. This card is uncommon. Hard Simpson is also uncommon. So there are going to be decks made where you have lots of both of these cards, which could actually mean like you have this combo turn that you archived up for, that you come in and you steal like three and then gain a ton because you're killing all of the stuff with one damage.
Yeah, I mean, yeah, this played. Card, it's okay. This, like,
I think this could be a combo card for a high value.
Sure. The discard that makes everything one power is not insane. So if that comes, well, so if somebody else plays that and then you hornswoggle it and then you Kerwall up.
Okay. Or borrow it.
Yeah. Well, okay. So we got some dreams to live there. But that's cool.
Yeah. A dream.
Okay. Pick up our
All right.
Next
loot
one.
Or pillage. Action in common. Loot or pillage. So play, you choose one. The loot side is just steal one. The pillage side is a friendly creature captures three. This is not a good card, guys. We literally just talked about being underwhelmed by like minimal incremental mass steal. This is about as minimal as it gets. And then, yeah, sometimes you're going to have to choose the capture three because you have to capture three to get them off key for key three. And then you're just gonna feel bad about
there
it.
There is like, the potential you don't even have a creature, so it does nothing.
Yes. Yeah, so
or, I mean, it steals one then, and it doesn't.
This is going to be like a one arc card. It's going to contribute one sass, almost no synergy. Like, if,
yeah,
I don't know.
I remember back in the day we talked about a card that said steal one was your definition of average, and now I don't feel like that's true
average.
Anymore.
That's why, like, Bait and Switch is a below average card. This will have almost the same arc and stats as Bait and Switch.
This card, like, is, yeah, this card makes me sad. Even if I had four or five of them, it makes me sad.
No, it's not. Because you're putting nothing on the board. You're not changing the board state. You're not changing the game state hardly. It's just not good.
Not good.
All right, Mug is coming back. Talk to us about the next
one. Our next one is called Scooped.
Oh, we already did that.
Yeah. So Scooped, which is a common action, gain an amber, another classic Shadows damage card, which says deal two damage. And if it is not destroyed, it captures one from its own side.
This is better than Mug. I like this one. So,
is this not just a worse version of the card from the last set that said, do two damage, if it doesn't kill him, steal one? Did that not
one
have
did
an
not
amber
have
pip
a
on
pip.
It?
It did not have a pip.
Okay, so then this is pretty cool.
This is better than the not looking, look over there, or whatever it is. I think it's look over.
Yeah.
I think this is better than Mug, which is inset, and Look Over There, which is the one you talked about from last set. And again, this is stealing, not have the word steal. Like, I'm going to keep pointing that out because that is a relevant thing these days.
Yep,
there are a bunch of decks out there with Discombobulator, Odoak, and Gargantuan.
Yeah. And I play a couple of decks that just lose to a Discombobulator.
Yep. One of the decks you are referencing, my wife lost with. To an awarded Odoak next to Taunt. It's just like, what the hell? Like, it's rough. Okay, Seeker Needle's back. Shoulder It is unfortunately back. Bring back Shadow Self. Come on, people. So looks like we're closing out with me, and Walk the Plank is a common action. On play, if your opponent has no amber, deal 4 damage to a creature. Otherwise, steal 1.
So, crap.
Yeah, again, we talked about the average value of certain cards. Dealing 4 damage to a creature, I think, is actually fairly significant. But that's only if they have no amber. Like, I would almost rather this be a card that dealt 4 damage to a creature.
This card could be a, some ore card instead of Walk the Plank. And have either do 4 damage or steal 1, and it would still be a bad card.
Yes.
Now, there is a lot of steel one. So with Logos archiving, there is the potential just to have a, you do whatever you do in your Logos, and then your next turn you take all your Shadows cards and you play them all and you steal six incremental one cards. That's a good turn.
Yeah, you steal 6 one at a time.
That's fine.
That's probably going to happen in this set. Like that the house is leaning towards it. There are a bunch of commons that ultimately steal one.
But so, if your hand is often what it is in this game, which is a 3-2-1 split or whatever, and you have one steal or two steal, it may not be enough to be, it may not make that swing.
All in all, though, I do have to say I was coming in expecting to be very underwhelmed. Some of these cards I had not seen. Just in going through the set just now, I think we did at least identify some synergies and combos that will be good. So I am less displeased than I thought I would be. I think Shadows might actually rank higher in my evaluation of Thorian now, whereas I definitely had them at the bottom.
So I felt like the reprints sounded like they were mostly pretty good cards.
Yeah, there's not a whole lot of whiffs. Like, I wasn't happy about Smiling Ruth or whatever, but like Whisper, Bren, I mean, even Bruno coming back is fine. Like,
Little Niff's not very good.
No.
But Scully Caper, you know, like, I'm not Scully opposed Caper's to a Scully fun. Caper. I mean, I'm underwhelmed.
Mac the Knife was always great. Depno, I liked both. Because of the way they play in their Omni capabilities, Depno, the Spymaster, and Mac the Knife are great. I just love the way they play. I think all in all, I would rank at this moment in time Shadows above Saurian, because like I stick fire with what I said to Saurian. Like, if it doesn't have most likely at least two Buried Riches, I probably will not have a Saurian. Like, it's just, it doesn't work. Like, there's not protection.
The thing I say is, after looking like we picked Buried Riches as doing some silly things, but in sealed play, there is so much other garbage incremental capture out there, just little bits of capture. We've seen plenty of it in just about every house, except maybe Lodos, that Very Riches may not be good because it's two-sided.
True.
Right, where I'm going to put you on a key to put me on a key.
Yeah, because then there was nothing that would really take them down. Cause, like, there's no dais, or you would have to, like, city-state Buried Riches and then city state again or something. Like, yeah, it's weird. I don't know.
Buried Riches, like, against
Coda.
Right, against Coda is gonna be brutal.
Or not even World's Clyde. So
not even like even there's a lot of capture in AOA. Well,
yeah, I guess AOA's, if you play against Sanctum, combo decks, there's though. Capture. Yeah. All right, well, I think that wraps us up. Shadows is done. Next week, we've got Star Alliance in the queue. I don't know where I fall at that. I probably looked at Star Alliance the least, and I'm a big tempo player, so I'm super excited to see what is coming down the pipe there. We will all hope you guys tune in next week. Have a great Easter.
Yep. Keep forging those keys.